Greetings. Bless the hearts of everyone who thinks materialism is a real thing. Physics, the grandest science of them all, has now utterly disproven materialism. Wow, is that ever a bold thing to declare, Texas? Not really, not once you have heard and understand the physics. The following video clip is from a video titled The Simulation Hypothesis. This is what the video thumbnail looks like if you search for it on YouTube. It is worth watching the whole video. It is 50 minutes and 40 seconds long. But it does not necessarily draw the same conclusion as I do from knowing what physics now knows. Let me give you a quick overview of what you are about to see in this clip. First, quantum entanglement. When two objects are entangled, affecting one of the objects also changes the entangled twin. It even does so when the objects are separated. Still entangled, but separated. Einstein called this spooky action at a distance. I'm being lazy, but you can find MIT OpenCourseWare that explains this fully. In fact, this effect has been observed with photons, atoms, even buckyballs, which are a carbon structure. So the first step is to entangle a pair of photons, then separate them. One of the twins is captured. The other twin is allowed to go through a series of half mirrors. The other twin is also captured. The first twin has a shorter path which takes less time. The second twin has a longer path which takes more time. Let me repeat that. The second twin has a longer path and takes more time. Just remember, the second twin takes more time to get measured. Something else to know is that earlier slit experiments prove that observation of the photons changes their behavior. And that is when things really begin to get interesting. Atoms only become atoms when someone looks at them. It's like the little dancing Groot from Guardians of the Galaxy. When you are not looking, the cute little Groot dances and moves and is much more than a tree sprig. Likewise, an atom is only solid when one is looking at it. Otherwise, an atom is a bit like a weeping angel from Doctor Who. So watch the video, but don't blink. The following is fair use for educational purposes.
Well, you may think that scientists would have run out of ways to do the double slit experiment, but you'd be wrong. The delayed choice quantum eraser experiment was first performed in 1999 by Marlon Scully, Yoon-Ho Kim, and collaborators. Dr. Kim was consulted to ensure the accuracy of this presentation. The experiment begins in the top left corner with a photon source behind the barrier with two slits. A crystal is placed in front of the barrier, which splits the photons into entangled pairs. This lens has the task of directing one of each pair, which have traveled through either slit, so that they will impact at detector zero. When a photon comes through the first slit and is split into an entangled pair, one of them flies through the lens and into detector zero. The second flies downward and is redirected by the prism into the green half-silvered mirror. Half-silvered means that they allow light to pass through 50% of the time. The other 50% are reflected. So, on average, half of the photons are reflected up in impact detector 4. The other half simply travel through, reflect off a full mirror, and reach another half mirror. They can either travel through it and hit detector 1, or be reflected into detector 2. Photons traveling through the second slit are also split up into pairs, with one traveling down and redirected by the prism. At the first half mirror, 50% are reflected and impact detector 3. The others travel straight through and are reflected into the second half mirror. 50% of these travel through and impact detector 2. The other 50% are reflected and hit detector 1. So, all the photons that came from the first slit on the red path could only impact detectors 1, 2, and 4. They can never reach detector 3. All photons coming from the second slit, the blue path, can only impact detectors 1, 2, and 3, but never detector 4. So any photons hitting detector 4 must have traveled through the first slit, and any photons hitting detector 3 must have traveled through the second slit. For photons that impact detectors 1 and 2, it is impossible to determine which slit they came from, because these two detectors can be reached from either red or blue path. The path of their actual origin has been erased by the experimental setup. So what is the function of detector 0? The results of the experiment are related to the time it takes the photons to travel through the apparatus. The shorter the path, the faster the photon reaches the detector, and the shortest path is always to detector 0. So when the photons are split up into pairs, one of them is always recorded at detector 0 first. And then, with a delay, the partner photon hits one of the other detectors. The coincidence counter records the results of all five sensors. It establishes a connection between the measurements at detector 0 with the partner photons that reach detectors 1 through 4. This way, each single photon registered at detector 0 can be precisely assigned to a partner at the other detectors.
Let's get ready to rumble!
This showdown was 2,500 years in the making, and it's for all the marbles, folks. They're playing for the entire universe. It's Plato versus Democritus. Idealism versus materialism. Head to head, winner takes all.
Now, this apparatus can get moving along at a pretty good clip. So they fire a whole slew of photons through here, let the experiment run, gather plenty of data, and then run the analysis. And what are the results? Detectors 1 and 2 always show interference patterns because it's impossible to determine which of the two slits the photons came from. But detectors 3 and 4 always show clump patterns because we can know which slit these photons came from. That is the only difference. How the light chooses to display itself as particles or waves is dependent on how much we know about it. If it had to come from just one slit, clump pattern. If it might have come from either slit, interference pattern. There is no materialist explanation for this.
There is no materialist explanation for this.
But even more mind-boggling is that the photons know beforehand which detector they will hit. How do we know this? Because of how the twin behaves at detector 0. Because the path to detector 0 is shortest, one of the split pair registers here first, before its twin ends up at any other detector. And whatever registers at detector 0 always correlates with where its twin ends up. So if one of the pair hits detector 3 or 4, detector 0 always displays a clump pattern. But if its twin lands at detectors 1 or 2, detector 0 always displays an interference pattern. Can the particle predict the future? Or is space-time a virtual construct with all time frames available simultaneously at the source of the simulation? Modern physics has definitely decided for Plato. The smallest units of matter are, in fact, not physical objects in the ordinary sense of the word. They are potential forms. In Plato's sense, abstract ideas which can only be described in the language of mathematics. Space and time are ideas as well, not absolute properties of nature. Science has decided. Materialism is not a valid worldview.
Particles are probability distributions, not little hard things. But when you measure them, like measure which slit they go through, you get a particle.
The wave that forms into a particle is only a wave of potentiality.
There is no way to explain the time relationship of the twin that hits detector zero before the second twin is observed or not observed. The video narrator describes this as the first twin knowing in advance what will happen later. The first always matching the behavior of the second twin that is impacted by the later act of observation. Let that sink in. The first twin always matches the state of the second twin that has something happen to it later, after the first is captured. Whatever happens at detector zero always correlates with where its twin ends up, observed as in detector 3 or 4, or unknown as in detector 1 or 2. There is, however, one scenario where such behavior is actually understood: a simulation. Atoms do not exist in the absence of observation.
Most physicists now accept that particles do not exist as objects in the absence of observation, but exist only as waves, which then form into particles when observed. These waves aren't anything tangible, like ocean waves or even radio waves, but simply a probabilistic description of where the particles might be if they were checked on. The atoms or elementary particles themselves are not real. They form a world of potentialities or possibilities rather than one of things or facts. When you look, they appear. When you're not looking, they don't necessarily exist.
Something about a human being observing it. As if the universe exists simply for human beings to observe. That gives me goosebumps. And it actually resonates with my theory that God created space-time simply as a framework where eternal human spirits may start, grow, and mature. The universe does not revolve around the sun. It revolves around human beings. And this hypothesis, the simulation hypothesis, is gaining acceptance because the evidence declares the reality of the situation. Physics has established that matter is not really solid. It behaves as a probability field, at least until a human being observes it. And thus, naturalism cannot explain reality and has not disproven God. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.